to introduce the speaker for tonight. Tonight's inaugural lecture is by Professor Akosua Agbabu Akofo. Professor Akosua Agbabu Akofo holds PhD in sociology from the Vanderbilt University, USA. Before then, she studied at the Vanderbilt University of Science and Technology, where she graduated with BSc in Architecture and MS in Development Planning. She also holds a postgraduate certificate in Spatial Planning from the University of Dortmund, Germany. She is a product of a Miguel's secondary school. She is a professor of African Studies and Gender Studies, and her teaching, research, and outreach address issues of African knowledge systems, higher education, identity politics, gender relations, and popular culture. She has been a visiting fellow and professor at universities around the world, including the University of Cape Town, Concordia University, University of Birmingham, and the Pennsylvania State University in the United States of America. At the University of Ghana, where she teaches, she has been a two-time elected member of the University Council, the founding head of the Center for Gender Studies and Advocacy, and a member of several statutory boards and committees. She's a founding vice president of the African Studies Association of Africa and an honorary member of the Human Science Research Council of South Africa. She served as an editor to many academic journals, such as the Journal of Feminist Africa and Gender and Society, and the Journal of Ghana Studies. In addition, she has numerous civic engagements, such as the chairperson of the Youth-Led Excellence Leadership Group and vice chair of the advisory board of the Ghana Institute of Linguistics, among many, many others. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Akomaku Akofo is a member of diverse national, regional, and international professional associations and civil society organizations like the Ghana Domestic Violence Commission, the Network for Women's Rights in Ghana, the Council on Social Science Research in Africa, and the U.S. African Studies Association. As a consultant, she has consulted for several organizations, including the Ghana Ministry of Finance, Save the Children, UNAIDS, UNFPA, and UNICEF. As a result of her outstanding contribution and scholarship, she has received many awards, such as the New Century Fulbright Scholar in 2004 and 2005, the Feminist Activism Award by Sociologists for Women and Society, in family life. She is the daughter of Joseph and Anna Adomaku, and she is married to Kwame Akofo, and she is a mother of many young people, including two daughters. She is a Christian and fellowships at the Calvary Baptist Church at Keshin. By way of hobbies, she enjoys swimming, travel, reading biographies, and watching biopic movies. She is an occasional painter and will not turn down a meal of coconut soup and a bumbulu with slaves. That is Professor Akosua Adonam. She is a fellow of the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, having been elected to fellowship in 2016. Her topic for tonight is Who Are We and Whose Are We? Identity and Transforming the Nation. Professor Tomaku, your audience, Professor Tomaku.
Ladies and gentlemen, apart, thank you once again for coming. Madam Chairperson, permit me to begin with a quote from the Bible, a text that has been influential in forging my own identity. I quote, "This God made us in all our diversity, allowing each culture to have its own time to develop, giving each its own place to live and thrive in its distinct ways." Acts 17:26. I believe where we find ourselves, and hence the scripture that I quoted, I believe that where we find ourselves on this earth is no random act. I believe there's a rhyme and a reason to our birthplace, and that therefore the responsibility lies upon each of us to ensure that this inheritance not only survives but thrives. It is our role in proactively ensuring this prosperity that I would like to engage with tonight. Reggie Rock Stone, who some have called the father of hip life, recalls pretending he was from New York while performing in London in the early 1990s. I quote him, "No one wanted to listen to African rap back then. It wasn't cool. It was dangerous. Caribbean kids would hustle you for being Nigerian or Ghanaian back then." Unquote. Last week, almost 20 years later, I heard a musician on Dorinando's Cosmopolitan Mix indicates that he wished he could work an American accent to help him sell his music. And of course, we all know that person who, after a short stay in the US or UK, acquires an unshakable other accent, and yet interestingly, never say a Xhosa or Bengali accent after an extensive period in South Africa or India. Sometimes assuming the identity of another can be strategic, even life-saving. But it is to the loss of our own identity and its possible recapture that I turn tonight. Madam Chair, before I begin, please permit me some acknowledgements. Again, let me thank all of you for coming. The weather has, as we sometimes say, brought itself, and some of you have had challenges in getting here. I really appreciate your presence. The Ghana Academy has very illustrious roots, and I'm honored to have been called to its fellowship. However, I have arrived here thanks to the investments that persons too numerous to mention have made in my life. Time will not permit me to name them all, and indeed, there are many who may be unbeknownst to me. However, a few mentions are required of me. In the academy itself, the larger academy, not just the Ghana Academy, many have worked hard towards bringing me to where I am today. And I'm very grateful for them and their input. In the Ghana Academy of Arts and Science, I'm especially grateful to Francis Ankara and Kate Mahinoa Kwankong, as well as Simon Trian, for preparing this evening's program. And I'm sure there are many others behind the scenes I'm not aware of. The The Institute of African Studies at the University of Ghana has been my intellectual home since 1989, and I have benefited greatly from the exchanges, arguments, and mentoring. Today, I want to particularly thank the Senior Assistant Registrar, Ms. Mavis Adote, and the Principal ICT Assistant, Mr. Eko Nsiwa, for their assistance towards today's lecture. Others also assisted in preparations for this lecture by providing references, ideas, and data. And I'm grateful to Mrs. Danielle Tufo, Akunu Dake, and Dr. Paul Ogumensa. A big thank you to Audrey Solomon of Richmond. Over the years, I've benefited intellectually, emotionally, socially, and spiritually from powerful sister circles, both at home and abroad. The fact that time will not permit me to mention all of them is a testimony to the expansiveness of this group, some of whom I see seated here tonight. Thank you very much, sisters, for coming. A special echo to my truly evergreen sisters, Bipol Sonayin, and to my girlfriends involved. My parents, of course, deserve gratitude for putting me on the path of learning and critical thinking. I will always remember being in class 3, and my mother giving me a set of books to quote, encourage me to learn my times tables. While I did grow to appreciate maths eventually, the curiosity for the written page became a passion, and I salute you both. I'll be grateful if you will join me in giving a hand to my parents.
Thank you also to my mother-in-law, Mama Ampofo, for having been supportive of me and my daughters. I'm sorry not all my siblings can be here tonight, but want to acknowledge my brother Kofi and his wife Marion from Germany. My brother-in-law, Professor Kwabnakro Ampofo, also traveled all the way from the University of Utah to be here, and I am grateful.
As for Kwame Ampofo, truthfully, my career as an academic would literally not have taken the trajectory it did without him. Husband, friend, life partner, encourager, co-conspirator, and our secretary. You have grown to become intellectual co-travelers and passionate citizens that I am proud of. If I had not given birth to you, I would have adopted you. I'm especially grateful to the millennials here tonight, and I would like to conclude my thanks by acknowledging the many young people who have been a source, some of the many young people who have been a source of inspiration for me, many of them my students over the years. Madam Chairperson, permit me to mention a few who have directly supported my preparation for this lecture, including participation in a simple WhatsApp survey. Edwin Asaije, Abnachre, Eresi Hammond, Akosua Asamabia Ampofo, Tikara Asari, Nora, Pintada Akon, Nefia Wuva, Nia Jesua, Abnachere, and Susie Afutu, excuse me. Thank you too to Samo Adame and Ifwa Kusan. I'm grateful to the XY group and to Akosua Samabia for the photo and video coverage. Last but not the least, thank you to Samo Adamangrempe of Web Depot for clothing me free of charge for the after party that I'm anticipating somebody will invite you to. It is to Ghana's youth that I dedicate this lecture, in the firm belief that in your hands our country's future is assured. This is no idle cliche, for I have seen the passion for Ghana in many of you as you strive to succeed against all odds. And despite the fact that we are your parents and grandparents, we may not have been the best role models. I know that my future is assured in your hands. When you watch award ceremonies, people often conclude with thanking the Almighty God. I do so now with a gratitude born of a 37-year war that persuades me beyond any doubt that I cast my lot for the right person. The continuing indiscipline and dishonesty in our country leaves many Ghanaians frustrated, even cynical, about our socio-economic development. We sit on wealth, and yet too many of our citizens are poor. The promises of independence eluded us much too soon. In fact, they never should have, and our nation has not really prospered. We seem to perpetually march in the byroads of potential, never arriving in the promised land of accomplishment. We all theorize, all of us in this room with ALS. The role of science is to improve our understanding of how the natural and social worlds work, and its value is that we can theorize based on a large body of evidence that can be applied more widely than our own individual contexts. As our millennials come in, thus we can make informed predictions about likely future scenarios based on this accumulation of science. And perhaps one of our failings as a nation is that science, industry, policy, and culture have not continued to live together as an Ekusua or family. This evening, I pray that my synthesis of our collective knowledge and my suggestions for our future, based on my analysis thereof, will be received as the ingredients of a coherent project for our national transformation. New Ghana. The responsibility belongs to us. We remember that. And then we are all involved. I would have sung it, but my daughters are warned me not to sing. We are can't say, prayer, say we back man, maybe, uka buma, emu. To wit, when you remove one broomstick, it breaks, but when you put them together, they do not break. And so this lecture is about our survival through the return to a collective identity project. My main arguments on the rest of this lecture are as follows. One, coherent and positive individual and national identities are critical for positive social and economic outcomes. Two, Ghanaians have mortgaged our personal and national identities and claim, including what Opoku Mensah refers to as outsourcing. He's here tonight. You will remember that I borrowed this phrase from him not too long ago. We have outsourced our intellectual engagement. Others own us, and this state of confusion about who we are has led to a condition of near collective identity crisis, even a kind of schizophrenia, for we have lost our sense of self-worth. This was best captured for me several years ago in the request a young man made that I should help him to get a visa. Clearly, he had an exaggerated view of my powers, but I ignored that for a moment, as I wasn't in the business of allocating visas, but was curious to hear what he had to say. So I asked him, a visa to where? He said, anywhere. Anywhere other than Ghana would work for him, outside. I generalize, of course, unfortunately, all hope is not lost. So, three, there remain, however, examples of innovative forms of resistance to this collective loss of identity. Millennials especially are reclaiming positive and productive identities upon which a strong national character can be built. And finally, four, I will conclude with a few specific ingredients that can guide the wider national transformation project through a repositioning. None of them you will recognize is new. Before I go on, Madam Chair, some disclaimers. In promoting a national identity project, I am by no means essentializing. However, In promoting a national identity project, I am by no means essentializing, however. And I'm not suggesting that there's a pure, authentic model of Ghanaians that we must all follow. As many have said, and as Abraham underscores in the preface to the 2015 version of his book, originally published in 1962, The Mind of Africa, the core cultural commonalities across Africa still hold. Two, my second disclaimer. I'm not saying that a cohesive national identity can solve all our problems. Obviously, we must deal with corruption and bad governance and inept institutions. However, I'm of the view that a sense of collective identity would marshal an army of civil-minded citizens who will not leave everything to government or a lazy or fatalistic attitude. And my final disclaimer is that I myself am not a perfect Ghanaian. I'm not innocent when it comes to some of the issues I will lay before you today. I know I will be on this journey of discovery until the day I join my ancestors. In that light, I hope if anything offends you, you will forgive me. One can learn who influences our thinking by examining those whose words we cite, our intellectual mentors. My contemplations are informed by the work of several intellectual guides and giants, and those I reference directly tonight are shown on the current slides. Madam Chair, permit me to share an anecdote. Alfred is a young Ghanaian student in the US who, along with my daughter Ida, visited me in New York while I was there for a meeting a few years ago. Thinking I was offering them a treat, I invited them to join me for dinner at an upscale restaurant in New York. Alfred respectfully declined and suggested that I give them the dinner money, which would more than suffice for dinner at a restaurant named Accra in Harlem, and the train fare to get them there. Identities about who individuals believe themselves to be, and food cultures are a core area through which we construct our identities. Just pay attention to the heated debates about whether Nigerian or Ghanaian jollof rice is the real deal. And as a sidebar, I wonder if you were aware that August 21st was Jollof Rice Day. Some say rice is not native to Africa. However, anthropological and archaeological studies show that rice has been cultivated on the continent for over 3,500 years. Between 1500 and 1800 BC, the species, and I'm going to struggle with this, Oryza glabrima, propagated from its original heart in the Niger River Delta and extended to Senegal. We are told that African rice helped conquer famine in the 13th century. Sadly, its cultivation eventually declined in favor of the Asian species. Today, we reject nutrient-rich brown rice from northern Ghana in favor of so-called perfumed higher rice. Other aspects of our expressive and creative culture include dress, music, and the arts, architecture, engineering, health, social customs, and importantly, language. Unhappily, African contributions to these have not only been erased from world history by others, but we ourselves have contributed to our own annihilation. Madam Chair, one would think this is a thing of the past, or some might think this is a thing of the past. So permit me a sidebar to mention just a few examples of these contemporary excisions. And the map with Africa right side up was designed by some young people who asked, why do we see the world in the way that it is presented? Why do we see Europe sitting on top of Africa? We might as well look at it this way. Sarah Barton, one of at least two famous Khoikhoi women who, due to their large buttocks, were subjected to life in human zoo exhibits in the 19th century in Europe. This was to help emphasize the stereotype that Africans were oversexed in the lesser race. She died in 1816 at the age of 26, but the story of her abuse, both in life and the shameful display of her remains, including her genitals, after her death, did not come to public attention until the 1970s. It has been well told by others. Pius Adesami, a Nigerian literary scholar, uses this abuse and excision to call attention to the erasure of African lives in academic discourse. In an interesting piece titled Sarah Bartman, Invisible, he produces a fictitious letter written by Bartman to Sandra Gilbert and Susan Hoover, whose book is on the slide, who produced the Norton Anthology of Literature by Women in 2007. Adesami by Bartman laments the, quote, excision of African theories and theorists from this 2,452-page two-volume collection. Where are the Africans? Another example is the 2013 Oxford Handbook of Modern African History. But the does not have a single African author among the 26. Lest you feel that a decade later, we may have moved on, in March of this year, Somaliland Journal of African Studies, a peer-reviewed scholarly journal founded by Rodrigo Vaz, a white male MSc candidate at the School of Oriental and African Studies at the University of London, was founded. It claims to have a focus on East Africa. The journal was made in collaboration with the University of Hargeisa's Institute for Peace and Conflict Studies in Somalia. Yet, the journal has no Somali involvement, not on the advisory board, nor among the contributors to the major issue. Vaz explains this lack of Somali authors thus, and I quote, "The content of our first issue had, unfortunately, no papers on Somalia, or by Somalis, for a simple reason. We received none," unquote. The technique whereby others collect our stories, publish them as exciting new research, get huge funding, publish so-called groundbreaking research, even though this has been common knowledge to us for centuries, is theft, if I can use that word. I need not talk about the misrepresentations that still go on to the news. Heartbreaking, but also they lead to a loss of income, and also the appropriations. And on this slide, you can see how Groom, Hinema, and Ghana Must Go are appropriated commercially. And one wonders where the Africans. The truncated story of Africa happened explicitly, such as by others telling our stories, excising us, inaccurate or downright derogatory representations, or sometimes it happened more surreptitiously, through what is endorsed or rejected in our everyday life. Why, for example, would we still sing a song about the bleak midwinter at Christmas, or hold on to that American accent when we are back in Ghana? When a so-called Western source of knowledge about our own societies is privileged over our Ghanaians, both by Westerners but also by Ghanaians, this reinforces notions of cultural superiority and inferiority, and undermines our ability to uphold a healthy self-identity. My own frustration in the university has been palpable for a privilege of the so-called international, sources, collaborators, etc. Who is international? Is the Nigerian not international to us? And yet when we say international, we are looking to the Western world. The saddest part is that over the years, we have guided ourselves by how we think we might and should be perceived by the outside, we white and Euro world. We have developed a sense of uncertainty and discomfort about who we are and our own value within the collective of humanity. I wish to say a few words, Madam Chair, theorizing about identity. This is where I will do some brief book-long things, so I beg you. In a world where individuals and nations do not all share equal access to resources or even an acceptance of their humanity, their national, ethnic, and racial identities remain indispensable parts of the whole within which we constitute who we are and fight for what is ours. Racial, national, ethnic identity are critical parts of the overall framework of individual and collective identity. From early childhood, some would say from the womb, as we are immersed in the cultural traditions, values, and customs of our societies through religious, familial, neighborhood, and educational resources, we typically develop a positive sense of identity and confidence in who we are as a people. Adambes, Dagombas, Ewes, Wans, Ghanaians, Africans, Black people, and so forth. With time, the images and messages conveyed in our social world can reinforce our comfort with our identities. They reflect and inform our ideologies, the windows through which we understand the world around us. Our identities, while not embedded in our DNA, are pregnant with inherited significance and value. are socially and culturally constructed. And we see what the National Commission on Culture's website has to say about our culture. A small note on differentiation. National identity pertains to individual subjective and psychological understandings, while nationalism refers to the active use of that identity towards a particular end, which could be negative and lead, for example, to genocide, or could be positive, leading to nation building. The sense of national identity can only endure if it is stimulated into a form of nationalism. Work from South Africa by Dickinson indicates that national identity provides motivation in micro-level processes of economic development. One of the young people in my WhatsApp survey noted that since Ghana is a young nation, quote, our sense of citizenship lies deeply within our ethnic backgrounds, unquote. Truly, we are a young nation of disparate African states, forced together through the slicing up of Africa by others. However, here we are. Another young person noted that our brief history notwithstanding, she felt that there had existed at one time a sense of cohesion. I quoted, I think we used to be prouder of our nation, of our leaders, of our people, even if this was only tied to the Black Stars. We've lost even that now. We have leaders who care about themselves more than the people. It's proud to call yourself a Ghanaian then, unquote. For purposes of time, let me summarize some of these other theoretical issues. Studies on nationhood teach us that despite ethnic and other affiliations, it is possible for superordinate identities to exist, which all members of rather diverse communities can subscribe to. For someone to act in a way that takes into account this me feeling, she or he must have a subjective understanding of what that we entails. And it must provide a sense of cohesion, unity, and motivation to act for a shared future. And if this shared future is perceived to be salient enough, then people find reason to act in ways that will improve their future and the we future. Further, for the we feeling to persist, it must be stimulated. This principle of nationalism has been successfully harnessed for economic development. Indeed, some argue that without this sense of nationalism, social and economic development will not happen. Writing on South Africa, Dickinson notes that creating and sustaining this national identity involves a knowledge and appropriation of one's history to serve the present. In Ant Hills of the Savannah, Chinua Achebe describes evocatively the place of the storyteller in the society. She or he knows the history of the people, but is more than a rote historian. She or he is a curator of the future. We can refer to the work of Friedrich List, the German economist, 1789-1986, who predates later development economists and is a father of national economism, and his debate with Adam Smith. His emphasis on the unity of labor versus Smith's on the division of labor. Add into the mix Max Weber's discussion of the Protestant ethic and its purported influence on economic development, basically capitalism. But we must avoid the pitfalls of seeing a straight Weberian causal relationships. We also do not want to go the route of the World Bank and the international financial institutions, who so broadly understand social capital that it can be found everywhere, and yet it fails to explain why development has occurred in one place and not in another. The bank itself recently responded by suggesting there is some social capital that actually helps, whilst there is some that hinders, and you may roll your eyes. To return to Dickinson on South Africa, unity and motivation resulting from a superordinate national identity has been evident. This manifestation has not, however, been in the simple form suggested by economic nationalists, such as List. The vision of a future associated with a new inclusive national identity clearly does provide motivation. To sustain cooperation, those subscribing to a superordinate identity need to make tangible steps towards the symbolic and material fulfillment of a shared vision. And that is all of us. While the ANC, for example, saw a common national identity in which Africans needed to take the lead as central to a successful transfer of power and transformation of South Africa, such a requirement was not counterposed against the individual's political and legal equality. In other words, our individuality is not lost in this national identity. I now move to the issue of our mortgaged identity. The years of struggle for independence and the ensuing years of national consolidation must have been exciting times, and was born thereafter. A sense of nationhood found expression in eclectic mixes of ethnic cultures forged into a national fabric. And of course, I generalize here, not everyone enjoyed this equally. Given recent, as far as I'm concerned, unnecessary controversy around notions of founders and founding fathers, and of course, the mothers, not surprisingly, are left out. It would be foolhardy of me to name nationalists. My references here are merely for ease of making my case. If was Sutherland, Pogna Sechi, J.B. Dunbar, Mabel Dunbar, and J.E. Kesehe, to name a few, epitomize the sentiments of early nationalists that the African's dignity, decimated by slavery and colonialism, can only be regained by upholding our distinctive cultures, and in particular, our languages. Indeed, they saw our very survival dependent on this. This was a central thesis of Kingsley Hayford's 1911 book, Ethiopia and Land, Sechi's The Blinkers, and Sutherland's Ifa. And I think that Sutherland was ahead of her time in the gender dimensions that are inherent in Ifa. Dunbar conceived of a nation in which we were all Adishi, which is royalty, thus building an Adishiman, a land royals. When Ghana's first president, Kwame Nkrumah, referred to the quote, African genius at the opening of the Institute of African Studies in 1962, he was declaring that our identity is based on our way of life, and that this would provide us the confidence not only to play our roles at home and in Africa, but also on the global stage. He stated inter alia that the Institute was to make, quote, specific contributions to the advancement of knowledge about peoples and cultures of Africa through past history and contemporary problems. Education must enable us to understand correctly the strains and stresses to which Africa is subjected, to appreciate objectively the changes taking place, and enable us to contribute fully in a truly African spirit for the benefit of all and for the peace and progress of the world. It is not only our leaders who have failed us. We, the intelligentsia, have a deep responsibility to provide selfless knowledge centered on the responses to our contemporary needs. The painting on the left of the slide is the piece that was donated by the government of Ghana in 1960, to the United Nations, and still hands the UN building. In addition to the Institute of African Studies, the period 1957 to 1966 saw the birth of many other cultural institutions and administrative structures of a national character. The National Theatre Movement was instituted in 1956. The Arts Council of Ghana, the cultural wing of the Ministry of Education, came into being by an act of parliament in 1958 to specifically administer the arts. The National Research Council and the Ghana Academy of Learning, that later became the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, and the Research Library on African Affairs and the Encyclopedia Africana project were created. Let us not forget the Uhuru Band. Kwame Nkrumah, Ghana's first president, directed in 1960 that all members of Ghanaian music groups should undergo a 6-month training in African music at the Arts Council of Ghana. After the overthrow of the CPP government, the state of identity markers of the national character suffered. The immediate post-CPP period evidenced a lack of concern for the question of organization and administration of culture. We can always measure government commitment by budgetary provision, and I see the Minister of Finance and I am grateful to him again for his serving over the years, and I will not go into the details of that. In the early years of the PNDC, however, this is worth mentioning, there appeared a certain commitment that WEB Boys, and I'm quoting from Akunudake survey, that the Boys Memorial Center for Pan-African Culture was established, the National Theater was built, and the Pan-Fest movement was also established. However, the commitment to these was missing under the PND successor, the NDC. After 1992, under the MPP, a cultural trust fund was established, but that can note that it did not really see an injection of funds to make the scheme operational. There was a reliance on foreign and short-term funding. This is reflected in the dubious euphemism of development partners who were involved. President Akufo-Addo's inaugural address offers hope that there will be a new commitment to government support for the arts and culture. Many of us still struggle with a damaged self-image. And we could find many examples of this schizophrenia. And I will be relying a lot, or a bit, on what my respondents in the WhatsApp survey said to me. One said, many of us still struggle to know who we are. This struggle and the resultant damaged self-image is what W.E.B. Du Bois described as a double consciousness, shaped by the perceptions and treatment that we have received from the Euro-American world. There are some notes on Du Bois for your edification. He says, it is a peculiar sensation, this double consciousness, this sense of always looking at oneself through the eyes of others. I've already hinted that our demise is associated with an uncritical admiration of other people's cultures. Even when we are exhorted to improve things, there's often a reference that we should do so for the sake of, quote, foreign investors. Let's talk about food. And I quote here from one of my young folks. You go to a supermarket and see Cadbury, Ferrero Rocher, and other brands on the shelf, and not Golden Tree. Good. We can talk of Indomie, and I'll have you. Okay, that's a spoiler alert. I have a note here that in 2016, we spent $13.96 billion nearly on the importation of fish. Add to that rice, plantain, chicken. You can imagine who is feeding us and the poison therein. Let's look at language. And hence the slide up there. I was very surprised to read in the graphic our first PhD that was written in Akan, the University of Ghana, and I sought verification from my linguist colleagues who said that indeed it was true. Quote here another one of my young respondents. She says, my baby speaks tree and ewe, and everyone sees her and says, how are you? Article 39.3 of our constitution indicates that the state shall foster the development of Ghanaian languages and pride in Ghanaian culture. May I please take that again, Madam Chair? The state shall foster the development of Ghanaian languages and pride in Ghanaian culture, our constitution. Language is inextricably bound up with identity in subtle ways. And many are of the view that our failure to embed our mother tongues in our discourse has had debilitating effects. As my sister Amma in this room complained recently, when you leave Kotoka or arrive, you hear English, sometimes French, never a Ghanaian language. Do we assume that all travelers should be speakers of the colonial language? Other African countries have done this. That is, incorporated mother tongues as national languages. South Africa, Botswana, Burundi, Central African Republic, Ethiopia, Kenya, Rwanda, Somalia, Swaziland. What is makes it so difficult for Ghana? The fact that English is the main medium of exchange, when we know that millions of our citizens communicate in their own languages, means that not only do we disenfranchise them, but we don't maximize their contributions to our society. There is no consensus about the precise number of living languages of Ghana, thanks to information that has been made available to me by Dr. Pokunesa. We know that recent work, also by Dr. Ansrit, puts the total of living languages at 59. Living languages means that there were languages that we spoke in the past, but which now have insufficient numbers of users to consider them as being able to survive. Some put the number between 50 and 80. The languages that are written in Ghana are around 50. Our language policies have contributed to this double consciousness of schizophrenia among our languages. Since independence, we have alternated between the use of English and the Ghanaian language in the early years. And you can look at the work of Ansred and Akosua Emeka Enugu, Paul Okumensa. From 1974 to 2002, the Ghanaian language was used as the medium of instruction for the first 3 years. In 2002, the government introduced a new policy which made English the medium of instruction from primary one, with a Ghanaian language study as a compulsory subject to the senior secondary, now senior high school level. That policy was eventually reversed in 2007. The truth, however, is that the policy of using Ghanaian languages does not enjoy general acceptance among Ghanaians, because people still believe that it will lead to poor learning outcomes and job prospects. The reaction following the former Minister of Education's remarks at a shared prosperity forum in October 2015 gives credence to some of our views about our own languages. At that event, she sought to highlight how the focus on English at the expense of the Ghanaian languages has affected the quality of education in the country. And some of the reactions that Okumensa notes are apparently unprintable, but I will give you one here. Oops. Some of us shall not sit down and allow this woman with backward thinking to ruin our people by introducing Ghanaian languages. I had to go to a program at Metro TV hosted by Paul Adebu. I forget what the subject was, but it was shortly after the then Minister of Education had made her statements about the use of Ghanaian languages that was to follow. And Mr. Adebu wanted to get my reactions to this and to more or less compel me to disagree with the use of Ghanaian languages throughout educational training. Paul Okumensa, Senior Language Policy Advisor for a USAID Ghana Partnership for Education Learning Program, that is working with the Ministry of Education and the Ghana Education Service to improve reading for 2.8 million children through the development of a Ghana Reading Action Plan, had some comments. He finds that the lack of representation or the absence of our own languages is symptomatic of a broader problem of the absence of African higher education institutions, including our universities, from policymaking and policymakers. For example, in putting together a working group to revise the current language policy in education, formal written request was sent to universities to nominate representatives to serve on the working group. Not a single university apparently responded. And yet when the Language Center at the University of Ghana was established in 1917, its mandate included researching into language use in education and within the wider context of culture and community interaction. Let me turn to arts and culture. Just ask a few questions. Where are our Anansi stories, patriotic songs, herbal medicine, lullabies? Mary and the Little Lamb? Really? Hollywood is making inroads locally and globally. But since love grew in the African courts like Owansa, It hasn't been that groundbreaking of a global movie from Ghana. Who is democratizing Tentebe? Attempts have been made in the last 3 decades by successive governments to define and promulgate a cultural policy, which is to provide a framework for the development of culture and the emergence of a new Ghanaian. Stakeholders in the sector have lost count of the number of drafts, review conferences, and revisions that the policy has seen. I am encouraged again by our president's comments at his inauguration, and I'm encouraged that again the Minister of Finance is here, and so we'll see culture getting the input it deserves in the national budget. Oh, I thought you'd laugh for me. Kofi Atukam, famous artist, had a mural in this nation. Where is it? I remember when Pediasi Lodge was being renovated some years ago, a friend who was driving past called to tell me that they were dismantling and removing all the old cultural artifacts, and they had just dumped them by the roadside. Being a forward-looking man, collected some, and this was just trash. Where are our museums? At a keynote lecture delivered by Dr. Atakwame, the recent African Council of Arts of the African Studies Association conference that was held at the University of Ghana, he told us about a museum that had been set up at KMUST under Professor Andam's vice chancellorship. Apparently, that museum no longer exists. We destroy old buildings daily to put up skyscrapers with glass windows. Usually the windows are blue, I'm not sure why. Our names, again, to quote one of my young respondents, Edwin says, with all the beautiful and meaningful names we have to add Hebrew and Telugu names before we think we belong to the 21st century. Why call a person Peace if I can call her Asundri? Need I say more about that? I don't know what one is trying to achieve. But it's not alone. If you ride in trotters, even if you don't ride in them, you must have seen the white Jesus at some point. I wonder how Jesus would have been white. The two other pictures you see there are from Makerere University that I had the opportunity to visit recently. They have a statue there of Kwame Nkrumah, and they have a bust there of Makerere. And some of you may have heard the controversy around Gandhi statue at the University of Ghana, and I would be remiss if I don't make reference to it. I was in a sabbatical at the time in the US, and I heard that there was a Gandhi for Calm Down movement, and I was like, what? Only to discover that there was a statue of Gandhi on our campus. A number of young people were quite upset about this for a number of reasons, which I will not all go into. But one of the major reasons was, we don't have any images of our own heroes, our own people on our campus. And should the first one that we put up be from somewhere else? We will not go into Gandhi's racist ideology here. For those of you who want to know the outcome of that, in Ghanaian parlance, it is still ongoing. Just some other notes about images and representation. You may be interested to know that black women globally spend twice as much on their hair as white women, as in dollar and CD terms. According to estimates, Africa's dry hair market, as opposed to the shampoos and the perming creams and conditioners, the market for weaves, wigs, and hair extensions is currently worth over $6 billion a year and growing quite rapidly. Some people spend roughly $250 a month on somebody else's hair on their head. Or somebody said to me, once you bought it, it's your hair. At least if we are going to go that route, let's grow the hair locally. As for our resources, mining balance, let's not go there. Last year, former president of the academy gave a lecture here on the mining industry and showed us how the successive governments have given our better rights by me. As a policy and a one government about what mining companies should provide to the nation, another government comes and knowingly undermines that. And of course, we know what is happening with all the incursions of people from other countries into that sector and what it has done to us. Our educational system. I will leave you to read what is on the slide and go forward and see it. Essentially, this is a textbook that is used in JSS primary. But you don't want your child to be reading what is in there. You know, of course, the corruption in the industry and what one has to go through as a publisher to get the Ministry of Education to accept your book. What about where we want to study? When I was a university student, doing as we call the consult was not, it was like study at home. It was those who couldn't make it at home and who went abroad. That has changed. But even if you wanted to go abroad, definitely don't go to another African country. And my former director and senior sister of diploma is here. When she went to do her master's at the University of Dar es Salaam, people were wondering, why don't you go to Tanzania? You can go to America or the UK. I believe, in fact, that she had opportunities to go to these places and chose very consciously to go to Tanzania. Our universities cannot get over impact factors. Who is measuring the impact? International journals. Who decides which journal is international? When Americans publish in their journals, is it international for them? Can't be publishing our journals and bring them to the standard that we want them to be. Why don't we privilege textbooks? I remember at one meeting on campus, we were discussing textbooks in promotion and how we don't really privilege those. And my brother, Professor Bukua Sam, asked, if we won't privilege textbooks, whose textbooks should we use in the classroom? Those written by other people? Architecture and our built environment. And what we've already referred to, the new classrooms, it's very strange. The product that you see on the left of the slide is cocoa that has been imported from, I'm sorry, it's on the same slide, I'm just trying to save space. Cocoa powder, it claims to be organic, that has been imported from Peru. 200 grams. 200 grams for 68 Ghana cedis. When I studied architecture many years ago, we were taught many things about climate and the kind of buildings that we put up. Professor Wellington, my former professor, is here. Sometimes when I look in the city, I'm sure that we all went to the same school. That's not what he taught me. The built environment is also an area where gender is very manifest. Anwar Dari's 2015 book makes the case for an urgent practice of critical spatial literacy for African women. Of course, gender is present everywhere, and I single this out because it provides a critical analysis in her book of how Asante women negotiate and understand the politics of contemporary space in Accra and the effect it has on their lives, demonstrating how they critically read that world. And we can do this in all the issues that we get. I now turn to the reclaiming of positive identities. Joy FM's open house party hosted by DJ Black. Zakaz, I suppose, the young people can tell me, most popular Saturday night radio show. Mixing Ghanaian, American, Nigerian, British, and South African pop, hip hop, and house music. One evening in September 2011, DJ Black implored his listeners, quote, "It's been a while since Ghana had a dance of its own, so please do the dance." He was referring to Azonto, a dance craze that was spreading around the country and among Ghanaians abroad. Azonto is a Ghanaian urban dance craze whose popularity is built through its global circulation. While the dance's origins have been contested, so I will not go there, it appears it was inspired by the song "You Go Kill Me" by star rapper Sarkodie and young producers L.M., released less than a year before the dance craze thing. One can trace its production and flow across studios, radio stations, dance floors, and digital platforms in Accra and among Ghanaians in London and New York. I argue that, as a technologically mediated style, Azonto is the embodiment of being Ghanaian in a mobile digital world. It has global relevance. Sarkodie's moves and what feels made of it in London have internationalized it. And I'm talking here about what young people in particular have been doing. Sarkodie, Manifest, Chatawale, Wiala, Little Wala. I could go on and on and on. Again, we have taken aspects of who we are and presented it in ways that is compatible with how young people feel and gives them that new feeling. Chalewote and Accra Market. Now, after Homowo, it also allows an insertion of Homowo into celebration of food and culture. Ebo White's Place. Chief Moments of the JK. And then I play on the song Lagoon and Adanga that I will refer to. Give us performances that allow us to look at history. In Wobbe JK, we are given a narrative of our beginnings as a nation to where we are today. Performed lively with dance drama. I recently went to see Songo, Our Life, Achiapo, Our Death, which is against a dance form of galanse in the salt industry. The Adan Songo Salt Women's Association, also known as Brave Women, are the performers. But they are not only the cast, they are also co-creators, delving into their own experiences expressed in Gambe oral tradition in new compositions. We can look at the Mofra Foundation. That seeks to insert our cultural traditions and reading and learning for young people. The Nubuke Foundation, Gospel Music, the Daughters of Glorious Jesus have done this for a long time. Joyful Ways, 26th December performance. Last year, the Center for Gender Studies and Advocacy had a competition for young writers, again trying to bring literary work onto our Ghanaian stage. And through Twitter and other online activism, it is also possible to have these sharing of ingredients. African youth especially have employed social media to deconstruct the privilege within spaces that are inhabited by us, the older folk, and especially the academy. While, quote, connecting communities internationally, strengthening the message that Black voices will no longer be undervalued in African and Black studies. What about Abraham Hatta? What have we done with him? So let me turn now to my concluding points, which is about ingredients for a national transformation project. And as I said, these ingredients will not be new to any of you. While the agony of our untold story, the truncation of our trajectory is real, I argue that we can plant what is good for our soil. We can strategically deploy our unique culture for our national well-being and progress. What would happen if we imagine our future from the perspective of the animated and creative spaces that most of our youth inhabit, rather than predominantly through broad institutional frameworks? And I quote again here, And she said, "You can't be proud of things you don't know. One of the things that separates us from the global north we so desperately want to be like is that they have perfected an art form of telling their stories in which they are always the heroes. There are a number of us who know Kwame Nkrumah, the names in between. What they did, we do not know, and then rolling to before, and so on. For me, history explains the present and gives a peek into the future. It's like introducing someone to your favorite singer. You have to talk about it for them to know." Unquote. It's no rocket science, as they say. So let's begin with our intellectual and educational system. Obinima, teacher, if you know, will show the way. It's the responsibility of us in the academy. We didn't get this education, this privilege, to just enjoy our lives. Our education must reflect our reality. Our history, our contemporary history, must also be taught. We need to return art, music, and literature to the classrooms. It was removed in those days when we said we wanted to do JSS, and we wanted people to learn practical skills. And then we asked them to learn computer science, and we didn't give them computers. Our president said in the nation's address, quote, "We intend to reform the basic school curricula with emphasis on literacy, numeracy, and creative skills." Hallelujah. The role of the National Commission for Civic Education. I don't know about most of you, and I don't want to offend anybody anymore than I probably have already done. But Charlie, we don't feel that. Civic education means that somebody needs to be telling us what our nation is about, what our nation can be. And I'll use this platform to say, NCC, please let us feel you. In terms of language, in April 2012, as part of the activities marking the 50th anniversary of the University of Ghana and Gilbert's relations, Gilbert is the Ghana Institute for Linguistics, Literacy, and Bible Translations, we jointly organized a conference hosted by the Institute of African Studies. I say we, because I'm from the Institute, titled 50 Years of Language Development in Ghana. A major outcome of that conference was the call to establish a national platform to advocate for the development of our languages in different domains of national life. On February 1st, 2015, Gilbert responded to this call by launching a national mother tongue advocacy platform, and I am hoping that this advocacy platform will be joined by many of us here to complain about the death of our languages. The new language policy proposed currently aims at the establishment of a language in education model that will support strong bilingual learning outcomes through the appropriate learning and use of Ghanaian languages. We need to reframe this idea that languages must be either or. When it comes to our resources, our economic policies have often been far removed from our reality. I spoke to an economic student who said while he was learning in the classroom, professor didn't know what he was experiencing when it came to the economics of his life. It's okay, he will learn it and pass. It didn't make any sense in terms of the reality he was experiencing. The neoliberal fiscal model that has required us to make changes in economic structures aimed at facilitating the growth of the private sector has not worked that well for us to date. For those who have benefited the most have been large and/or international corporations. Indeed, some refer to a worldwide crisis of the neoliberal model. Abraham foresaw this almost 60 years ago in the mind of Africa when he argued that we paid insufficient attention to the quote, soft cultural or mental infrastructure, unquote. In a 2014 article by Tandika Mkandawere titled, quote, "The Spread of Economic Doctrines and Policy Making in Post-Colonial Africa," he looks at the relationship between economic ideas and policy making over the last half century. The recourse by Western countries to policies they declared taboo for us, bailouts, nationalization of enterprises, stimulus packages, subsidies, support the critics. This should prompt us to be more autonomous in our research and to free ourselves from donor-mediated agendas. We also need to fix the disconnect between intellectuals and policymakers. When do we speak? And when do we speak to whom? And who listens to us? Research and development show the links between facets of identity and development and leadership. We need to invest in our artisans. Indeed, as Dake notes, the living condition of many of our creative workers, artists, and cultural entrepreneurs is abysmal. Yet we want these crafts to survive. When it comes to food, we have the dubious distinction of being the country, or at least one of the countries, that imports the most food on the continent. In the present State of the Nation address in February, he said that he aimed to popularize farming by encouraging many people to take it up as a full or part-time job. A national campaign, quote, Planting for Food and Jobs, will be launched to stimulate this activity, according to our president. An amount of 125 million Canadian dollars has been secured from Canada to support this initiative. And the campaign will be anchored on the pillars that will transform agriculture: provision of improved seeds, the supply of fertilizers, the provision of dedicated extension services, a marketing strategy, and the use of e-agriculture. Water and dams are also to be involved. The district assemblies will be tasked to identify and register progressive farmers in each of the 216 districts. Many students of agriculture have said this, and it has been eloquently captured by George Benin in his 2011 book titled Technology Should Seek Tradition. He says, unless we respect, understand, and incorporate traditional farming systems and knowledge, we will continue to experience the failure of modernizing agriculture. Time will not permit me to go into the details of the policies that we have had as a nation when it comes to agriculture. But suffice it to say that the organic revolution that has swept the globe should tell us that our farmers have it right all along. One year, Paribia and Kofo did some research among farmers in Peru a few years ago around the GMO debate. She found farmers in Peru who were aware of the Plant Breeders Bill, who had not been consulted on this, had any of this discussed with them, and who complained that new breeds of cassava that they were being made to grow, while growing faster, they were not able to sell because it was not good for them. Who wants to serve our economy? Art and theatre. For Atua Bedu, a physician turned cultural artist, I quote, art is a story, whether it is painted on canvas, sculpted in a rock, recited as poetry, sung, performed as a dance, or staged as a play. She goes on, many believe that technology or science is the way forward in development. This is a physician's speaking. But science and technology only have assistive power, not causative strength. The real drive forward into the future is the story that is heard, known, held, and believed properly. It is what many are looking for in the idea of the African Renaissance. It begins with thought and creativity, the arts, literature, theater, dance, then art in science and art in technology. It begins with vision and hope, unquote. The case for the arts in building a national vision was put most elegantly by Kwesi-Anka at the recent conference on the Arts Council of the African Studies Association. And I think people will be well advised to read that speech. He called for us to review our artistic traditions, build new ones, and mainstream our visual material and verbal arts. He has by no means an exhaustive list. Museums, archives, national galleries, folk songs, monuments, celebrations of artists, films, festivals. Farming, a keynote speaker at the same conference, pointed us to a 1962, I believe, curriculum of the arts was required. One of the young people in my survey said, each district should have a program once a year to inspire the youth. I'm almost at the end, and I would like to share. Here are some representations in our churches. We see in the extreme right, Kofi Kwakye's implementation of an Africa in Jesus. Catholic Cathedral of Mercy, we see generally kingly umbrellas in the church. I'm sorry, I've shown you these slides. Here we see celebrations of our heroes, Mbejeke, and the advancement of Sambo Theater. Now, I just want to share with you on these slides, I'm not going to add some of the biographies and autobiographies that are increasingly becoming important. And I would highly recommend as education on our history, so much of which is not being written. Let me praise the Institute of African Studies, where I come from, for their project on prominent Ghanaians, series of autobiographies that include the late Oyema Gwanga II, who was University of Ghana's Chancellor, an international civil servant and businessman, the late Yakubu Tali, an educationist, diplomat, politician, and traditional ruler, Dr. Kovnat Kufuor, economist, politician, banker, and philanthropist, Azuma Pamba, entrepreneur and politician, Professor Florence Dolphin, the first Ghanaian female professor, and first and until date only female board vice chancellor. We had an acting one. Dr. Kuan Kofu, physician, founder of the Center for Research into Health and Medicine and an artist, and the Honorable Justice Anija Gay, Justice of the Court. You see other biographies, works that have been provided. Many people seem not to fully appreciate the AFRC, PNDC, and NDC years, and I highly recommend that Professor Ivana Gainas's biography on Hilalman Robert. And some other biographies and autobiographies that have been written in recent years. I would also highly recommend the collection of essays by Bisiyan Gaga, Adlaye Boafare, and Ms. Ohene. I have chronicled the ideas in the newspapers, and I would give an insight into, for our young people, into many of those years that they seem not to be aware of, and the sometimes over-glorious image that they have of certain leaders in this country who have made attempts to rewrite history. Ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, friends, this list of ingredients for transformational Ghanaian that we can all put our hands into, that we will not leave to government, that we will not say, well, we will believe in our God. I think that faith must be action. And on that hopeful note, I'd like to thank you once again for your attention and for being here.
Critical appreciation of other people's culture. And this is reflected in our languages, in our food, in our education, and the list goes on and on. I believe all of us here have learned great lessons from the presentation, either as individuals or as members of different institutions. And it is time for us to reclaim our identity as Ghanaians and harness them in different ways to transform our nation. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, you will agree with me that Professor Adomako Ampofo has done justice to her topic, and in so doing, she has given us all food for thought. And I believe, as we live here, we will remember the issues she raised and claim them and use them to transform our identity as Ghanaians. Professor Adomako, thank you for that stimulating and motivating. And we believe that we will take the lessons along as we continue working with your research to feed in to the national agenda. Thank you very much for coming.
We would like to thank the chairperson for the remarks. At this juncture, we're going to break protocol. There are three groups here who would want to do presentations to the speaker. Well, these are, I think, the Institute of African Studies, SEGRA, and then Volta Hall. So please, may that come. We normally don't do this, but we'll allow it. I trying to get an eye on that. Please, okay, it will be here. I've been signaled that refreshments for special guests will be here. Ladies and gentlemen, we come to the end of this exciting evening, and we would need to do that. You rise as the party here.